Dear friends, good afternoon. Welcome to this session on China's G20 agenda.
Majority of today's session panelists are Chinese, and also I guess majority in this room are in Chinese too. So I think we will speak in Chinese quite a little bit. So I just encourage our foreign friends to use the simultaneous interpretation system to help.
A warm welcome to all of you. Thank you for attending this very important session on China's G20 agenda. As you know, after the 2008 to 2009 global financial crisis, G20 has become the most important global governance structure. And the total population of G20 countries account for two-thirds of the world. Combined GDP of G20 countries account for 80% of the global total. So that is why G20 matters so much. And China is the presidency, assumes the presidency of G20 in 2016. And China has already been playing a very important role on the G20 platform. We have proposed innovative, interconnected, and inclusive as the key words of the G20 summit to be held this year. And during the last round of discussion, we have already had fruitful results on the discussion of various topics such as inclusive growth, innovative growth, and interconnected growth. So we are counting down till the opening of the G20 summit. We are 70 days to go to the summit, and when we are doing the 100-day countdown, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of China has held an important event. And today we are gathered here to discuss the priorities, the direction, and the roadmap to be discussed at the G20 summit. And today we are joined by Vice Minister Li Baodong, Vice Minister of China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And this ministry is the shepherd of the G20 summit. Without further ado, I'll give the floor to Minister Li.
Ms. Moderator, distinguished guests, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is my great pleasure to join you at today's forum and discuss this important topic. And I'd like to welcome you to this sub-forum on the G20. The theme of this sub-forum is China's G20 agenda, new drivers and a new starting point. And the theme of the annual meeting of the new champions is the fourth industrial revolution and its transformational impact. Clearly, the theme of this sub-forum very much echoes that of the annual meeting of the new champions. They are both about keeping abreast of the times and promoting innovation-driven growth. Today's world is on the cusp of a scientific and a technological revolution as well as industrial revolution, with new technologies and new forms of business constantly emerging. Innovation is profoundly changing the way we live and work. It is contributing more and more to economic growth and becoming one of the main drivers of development with immeasurable promise. At the same time, the world economy is going through profound adjustments and facing many challenges. For example, Brexit is a sudden challenge confronting us. Global growth remains sluggish and fragile under persistent downward pressure. The old practice of simply relying on fiscal and monetary policies to stimulate the economy is running out of steam, and we must have new concepts and new visions. The marginal effect of the old practice is decreasing. The clear divergence in the macroeconomic policies of the main economies makes coordination even more difficult. Trade and investment protectionism is on the rise, and a lot remains to be done to build an open economy. The G20 is widely recognized as the premier forum for international economic cooperation. It is an important platform and a mechanism. At this critical stage of the world economy and international economic cooperation, the world looks to the G20 for visions and actions which can help the world economy overcome difficulties and lead the way forward and point the new way forward. So as this year's G20 president, we are humbled by the tremendous responsibilities on our shoulders. Last year, under the Turkish presidency, the Antalya summit was very successful under the theme of three eyes. As the Chinese saying goes, a wise man changes as time and circumstances change. Given the current circumstances, we hope that building on the success of last year's Antalya summit, that by hosting the Hangzhou summit, we can further advance the G20 agenda, focus on the core challenges and pronounced issues facing the world economy, and work with all parties to find long-term solutions and contribute China's wisdom. For that, China has made towards an innovative, invigorated, interconnected, and inclusive world economy the theme of this year's summit, and set four main topics, including innovative growth models, more efficient global economic financial governance, robust international trade and investment, and inclusive and interconnected development. These are our four main topics. Since we took over the presidency on December the 1st last year, we have held three Sherpa meetings, as the moderator mentioned. We also held two meetings of the finance ministers and central bank governors. Working mechanisms on growth, innovation, development, trade, investment, finance, employment, energy, and infrastructure have held several rounds of meetings. And rounds of discussions and in-depth discussions have been held. Just yesterday, the third G20 Sherpa meeting was concluded in Xiamen. This Sherpa meeting is highly crucial in the preparation for the Hangzhou summit. The meeting had discussions on the framework of the leaders' communique to be issued at the summit. What kind of deliverables will come out of this summit? And through these deliverables, how can we promote world economic growth and realize strong, sustainable, and balanced growth is our objective. And those are what have been discussed at the third Sherpa meeting. The various parties at that meeting had in-depth and extensive discussions on the framework of the leaders' communique and possible deliverables. Basic consensus has been reached, and I'm very happy to use today's opportunity to brief the business community that this Sherpa meeting has been very successful and produced a lot of consensus. We have a lot to look forward to. And I want to use today's opportunity to share with you the main possible outcomes and consensus that has come out of this Sherpa meeting. First, we need to innovate growth models and tap growth potential. This is the core task of this year's summit. and also the first time the G20 focuses on innovation. We will formulate the G20 blueprint on innovation growth, seize the new opportunities brought by innovation, new industrial revolution, digital data, and structural reforms and other factors. Strengthen the supply side and address the lack of growth momentum from its roots. So this blueprint will be a highly important document that will point the way forward and promote long-term sustained growth of the economy. This blueprint will not only identify new and strong drivers for world economic growth, but also help formulate a host of specific action plans in relevant sectors. So a strong feature of the Chinese G20 presidency is that we need to put forward a vision, a roadmap, and plans. That is why we will put in place a host of action plans to realize our vision. We will have the visions, actions, and mechanisms in place, which together will usher in a new path towards growth. We'll fully harness the fiscal and monetary policies, address immediate challenges without losing sight of the future, and we also need to identify the priority areas, guiding principles, and indicators of structural reform, and raise the total factor productivity and the mechanisms and the medium to long-term potential of growth. To tap these growth potentials, we need to have some action plans and mechanisms in place so as to realize the vision. Second, we will promote more efficient global financial and economic governance and provide a strong guarantee for world economy. We'll continue to advance reform of international financial institutions, improve the international monetary system, and increase cooperation on infrastructure investment, financial regulation, international taxation, energy, and fighting corruption, and make the global economic governance more balanced, reliable, and effective. We'll encourage the IMF to complete the 15th General Quota Review as soon as possible and further strengthen the global financial safety net and uphold international financial stability. We will push for the formulation of the high-level principle on fugitive repatriation and asset recovery by the G20, establish a research center on this subject matter, and formulate the 2017 to 2018 anti-corruption action plan so that we will have the principles, the mechanism, and actions to fight corruption and make it impossible for any corrupt officials to hide in any G20 country. That is our objective. And we are very organized in our approach to this campaign. We will have overall plans and we will have specific action plans to translate that vision into reality. Third, we need to further promote international trade and investment and revitalize the world economy. This year, China is trying to put trade and investment on the G20 agenda and has built institutionalized platforms such as the G20 Trade Ministers Meeting and Trade and Investment Working Group. This is also the first time this has been done in the history. And this can help revitalize trade and investment as the two engines. And we will also formulate the global trade growth strategy and the G20 guiding principles for global investment policymaking. And these policies do not come out of thin air. It is based on our previous discussions from previous summits, especially from the successful discussions of the Antalya summit. Those are very inspirational. And today we have with us the Turkish coordinator. Here, I really thank her for coming here, and the Antalya summit has been a great source of inspiration for China as the president of this year's G20. The global trade growth strategy is aimed at reversing the decline in trade by coordinating trade and investment policies, lowering cost of trade by facilitating measures, and increasing trade financing. The G20 guiding principles for global investment policymaking is highly innovative and will provide a non-binding policy guidance for cross-border investment cooperation. But of course, the formulation of such multilateral investment rules will not be a smooth sailing and cannot be achieved overnight. But what is important to get the process started. And China, with this Hangzhou summit, is trying to get the process started and demonstrate our strategic vision and leadership on this issue. Therefore, we believe to start this process is of long-term strategic and overarching importance. Fourth, we need to promote inclusive and interconnected development and implement the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. This year, the G20 will realize two firsts. For the first time, development issues will feature prominently in the global macro policy framework. And for the first time, an action plan will be developed to implement the 2030 Agenda on Sustainable Development. These are the two firsts for this year's G20. We hope that our collective and national actions will provide strong support for implementing the Sustainable Development Agenda. And this year, China will encourage G20 members to cooperate and take such steps as capacity building, increasing investment, and improving infrastructure to help Africa and LDCs to accelerate industrialization, reduce poverty, and realize SDGs. We hope that by formulating the Global Infrastructure Connectivity Alliance Initiative, we can promote cooperation and coordination between the existing regional and national infrastructure plans and enhance global infrastructure connectivity. With the Chinese initiative and the support of various parties, the Sherpa meeting last April issued the first president's statement on climate change in the history of the G20. This is unprecedented, and this is an early harvest for the Hangzhou summit. We'll continue to encourage the various parties to expedite the ratification of the Paris Agreement on climate change so that it will enter into force at an early date and contribute its share to international cooperation on climate change. In addition, we'll also work for G20 action plans and cooperation initiatives in inclusive finance, green finance, energy accessibility, renewable energy, and food security, as well as employment, so as to contribute to the sustainable development agenda from different perspectives. As an old Chinese saying goes, the ocean is vast because it admits all rivers. China stresses openness in hosting this summit. We have been actively reaching out to other parties and carried out all-round and multi-tiered G20 outreach dialogue. We are open to various suggestions, and we will ensure that the G20 will pool wisdom, create synergy, and benefit the people. This year, China plans to host 6 side events for the G20, including the Business 20, W20, Women 20, Labor 20, Civil Society 20, Youth 20, and Think Tank 20. These will be the 6 side events. And this is also based on past practices, especially on the suggestions of Turkey and Russia, as well as other previous presidents. The W20 was already successfully held last month, and it is worth noting that China will host the largest ever B20 in the history of G20. The B20 will be unprecedented. about 1,000 participants will attend the B20. And it will be held back-to-back with the Leaders' Summit. As for how many people can attend, it really depends on the scale of the hall, the meeting hall. We need to create conditions for the exchanges and interactions between the G20 leaders and the business community, and create very favorable conditions and favorable opportunities for such interactions. And this way, the voice of the business community can be better reflected at the Hangzhou Summit, and they can make greater contribution to the world economy. So this year's sub-forum, the sub-forum on G20 today is also an important opportunity for us to hear the voices of different parties so that the outcomes of the Hangzhou Summit can reflect the aspirations of different parties as much as possible and foster the broadest consensus possible. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, as the moderator said, the Hangzhou Summit is only 70 days away. We have come to a very crucial stage, and China will stay open, inclusive, and transparent in hosting relevant events and work with all parties to make sound final preparation for the summit and ensure that the Hangzhou Summit will produce positive outcomes that will benefit the whole world in the long run and contribute to strong, sustainable, and balanced growth of the world economy. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much, Minister Li, for giving us a comprehensive speech on the topics to be discussed on G20. And this is such a clear and rich agenda. So we shall be looking forward to the fruitful discussions to be held at G20 Summit this year. And on my left-hand side, we have a collection of stellar experts. First, Mr. Zhang Yuyan, Director of Institute of World Economics and Politics of China. And just now I've listened to Minister Li's speech, and we have the counterpart from Turkey present here, who's the G20 shepherd last year, Deputy Undersecretary of Economic Affairs of Turkey. And next to, next is Professor Li Daokui, Dean of Schwarzman College of Tsinghua University of China. Time is running short. I hope that the following discussion will be interesting and rich.
Because we know that the Turkey has had a very, very successful G20 last year, and now we have a Troika mechanism in G20, and we have actually Turkey, China, and Germany. So what kind of the experiences that China can learn from the Turkey? And also, what kind of suggestions do you have from China to have the continuation of the G20 agenda, while at the same time try to build a leadership in the global community? What is your suggestions?
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to express having such a privilege to be on this panel. Let me say that we are working within the G20 under the very able leadership of Minister Li to bring the Hangzhou Summit to a successful, in fact, conclusion. We have already seen that China has made a lot of progresses, in fact, on many of the areas. In fact, I mean, this is a tradition of the G20 because we do not have a permanent secretariat. And it is a big responsibility, in fact, to steer the work of G20. And for that reason, we have this established practice tradition working within the Troika. What we do with this established practice, in fact, we try to assure the continuity of the G20. But of course, each presidency presents new ideas and refresh, let's say, and adapt a new emerging, let's say, the agenda of the G20 to the new emerging risks. Last year, for example, I mean, during our presidency, defined our priorities as the three I's. And we are very glad that this year China is continuing, although with a very different emphasis on different topics, with four I's. This also shows the continuity. And inclusiveness was one of the Turkish presidency's, in fact, priority. And this year China is continuing on that because inclusiveness, we put a high emphasis on inclusiveness because inclusiveness is important not only within our nations, but also among nations. Rising inequality, in fact, is a phenomenon which is taking toll, not only, social, political results, but also implications, but also for it is taking down the potential of economic growth. That's why, I mean, China is continuing putting a high emphasis on inclusiveness. But of course, China has presented, I mean, this is the dynamics. There are some criticism because some say that, I mean, G20 doesn't have a permanent secretariat. But this gives the dynamism of the G20 because every presidency wants to be successful. And you work very hard. In fact, I know from my practice for the last 1.5 years, I didn't have any weekends. In fact, it is the same case, I'm sure, with our Chinese colleagues. But this is the unique aspect I mentioned of the G20. And China this year, in fact, we have two basic problems: low productivity and slow growth. And with all these new three I's, innovated, invigorated, in fact, new industrial technologies, and China has brought new dynamism, in fact. Now we are looking at the future of our economies. That's why I think the continuity is important, but every presidency, in fact, brings new agenda items on the G20.
Thank you, Ayse, very much. 刚才呢，这个宝东部。
Just now, Minister Li has mentioned several first time. For example, he talked about China's future leadership. This several first mentioned, we're going to talk about a digital economy, innovative growth, which is going to be the first time. And also SDG goals of the UN will be linked to inclusive growth at the upcoming G20 summit. Also, as Minister Li put it, in addition to G20, there will be W20, B20, Y20. And today, a leader, Professor Zhang Yuyan, representing T20 from China, is present here. And Minister Li has shared with the official G20 agenda with us. And Professor Zhang, from an academic point of view, in terms of T20, what kind of contribution can T20 make to G20? Thank you.
Thank you, moderator. The Research Institute and the other two partners and MOFA have been identified as the chairs for the upcoming G20 summit. So with the past president, Tapas, which is from Turkey, and also working with the two partners, two think tanks from Germany, the next presidency. We are working closely among ourselves. Since December last year, we've organized a number of seminars and discussions, which not only took place in China, but also in Germany, in the US, in Peru, in Geneva, Switzerland, India. So a number of meetings already took place. And the idea was to make sure we can really play a constructive role at the next G20 meeting. And of all the comments and suggestions we collected, I want to highlight a number of points. And Mr. Li already talked about a few. I was really struck by the fact that many scholars, when it comes to China's presidency this year, hold a lot of high expectations. So I was struck by that. Second, about the whole G20 process and putting G20 as a lasting mechanism and institutionalizing this mechanism, there's been a lot of suggestions. And Sherpa meeting, for example, is one of such processes. So people are questioning whether we should institutionalize the process. And some are arguing, saying that there are still some problems with that idea. And also, the process works because we have many ministerial meetings, the Sherpa meetings. And this year, when China is the presidency, we have also added the frequency of the Sherpa meetings. So this is already quite working quite well. So what's your personal opinion then on this matter? I still want G20 as one of the most important governance platforms to be stable, enduring, and institutionalized. I also want to add, which is quite interesting, I might have to say, that China has put development issues at the heart of all the discussions for the G20 summit, and this has received popular support from scholars and the academia. And some are saying that for the next meeting in Germany, we should also try to feature development issues at the center. This is interesting. Development issues as the centerpiece of the discussion of the agenda is not just the call of developing countries, because scholars from developed countries have echoed that proposition. So that's very gratifying to us and a bit of surprising. So identifying development issue as the centerpiece of the agenda is really a point of satisfaction to us. When we talk about trade growth deceleration, people are saying that trade and investment are now facing headwinds. On that point, we have seen the true wisdom of scholars and experts, because in Geneva, in meetings, people talked about trade statistics, because trade today is very different than trade yesterday. For example, in digital economy, a lot of trade transactions are not counted the usual way, because a lot of trades and e-commerce have been counted in different statistics. So trade growth has been lower than GDP growth. Probably we underestimated China's cross-border e-commerce, because a lot of the trade is flowing that way. Yeah, there's been a lot of discussion saying that probably the whole statistical methodology has to be rethought, because it's not commensurate with the way it is, things are. So that's one thing that struck me from the discussions. Thank you, Professor Professor Zhang. So Professor Zhang echoed Mr. Yang's points about the framework and also some of the key discussion points from the meetings. Next, I'd like to ask Mr. Li from Tsinghua University. There's been a lot of discussion on trade and investment, but on financial matters, there's been less discussion. We know Professor Li is a renowned economist and financial expert. China has been trying to work on SDR-China joint last September, so there will be an unfolding process. Also, the use of the RMB in the SDR basket is a very important agenda item. And also, International Financial Architecture Working Group has been inaugurated this year during the Gans Summit. But there's been some suspension of that process for 2 years. So China reactivated the IFA, and under IFA, there's been a lot of big ideas like financial regulation and governance. And Professor Li, we know you are the expert in this field. So maybe on IFA, how does China set the agenda for G20? What expectations and what progress should we have? Madam Yang asks a question that is easier for insiders to answer, but I'm only half insight. So the Shepherd meeting, the Shepherd meeting is led by China this year. So we have the chef. We have the sous chef, and I'm not in the kitchen. One of my feet is in the kitchen because I was involved in some of the discussions. So I want to lay down the context, the background for you. About 20 years ago, it was a ministerial conference, the G20 summit. And then after the global financial crisis, it was elevated to a presidential sort of meeting. And the frequency has also intensified. So in my observation, coming from the outside, I don't know whether you agree with me. I think the Chinese are very pragmatic. We are playing a low key. We are modest because 11 meetings are already past us. And there's been a call for China to become a host. So we were not a host in the first 10. But now we are hosting the 11th. So I think China was humble in that sense. And the Chinese have the tradition of making commitments only when we think it's serious. So we don't make commitments easily. So I agree with Vice Minister Li. In his keynote, he mentioned a few satisfactory points. He said it's like opening the room for guests. So we have some surprises. We have some big meals in store for you. We have something delicious. For example, speaking of the B20 summit, it's going to be packed. Many people will show up. So the political leaders and the business leaders can have a discussion back to back, and then they can take the mandate from the political leaders and implement. I also want to interpret the involvement of trade ministers in the G20 summit, because historically, three ministers were very busy. So foreign ministers, central bank governors, so they have to be at the summit. They have to be in the preparatory meetings. But trade ministers were not as prominent. So in July, we're going to host the trade ministerial meeting in Shanghai. So this is one point of innovation coming from China. And innovation is necessitated by the place of trade in the global economy. So trade ministers have to be at the table, not just the finance ministers or the central bank governors. That's one feature. Another is
And secondly, based on my observation, at every G20 summit, when the chef cooks a large set of meals, when the meal is on, not all participants want to discuss, want to eat that meal. For example, there was the Eurozone crisis, and there were the terrorist accidents. Well, right now it's hard to predict what exact topics will be discussed. Maybe Brexit is going to be a hot topic. Let me interfere by saying that Brexit is, we are going to discuss Brexit in a moment. I guess the leaders of G20 countries will talk about Brexit. Could you share your opinion on Brexit with us, Professor Li? Well, I'm going to talk about that in a minute. For example, maybe the leaders will say that we shouldn't just resort to the referendum to make such a big decision on whether to stay, to remain, or to leave the Eurozone. And next, let me talk about issues related to the financial services sector. Well, as an outsider, maybe there will be discussion on SDR, special drawing rights. SDRs have been here for about 40 years with very little role to play. SDRs are basically creating an international currency to be circulated around the world, but SDR amount is so small, accounting for only 2% of the global reserve, monetary reserve. So SDRs play a very small role until today. So perhaps at the upcoming G20 summit, countries might propose SDRs are only used as nominal currencies, but it will not be used as an actual circulating currency. And also quotas of SDRs might be increased so that SDRs can become a true international currency, especially a reserve currency, and we will be able to reduce the dependency on the US dollar as a major international reserve currency. So these might be appetizers for the big G20 meal. Thank you, Professor Li. He did not read into the communique, ministerial communique published in the last February and April, and yet he was able to share such insightful views with us. Professor Li has talked about the unpredictabilities that might happen in the world, such as Brexit. Brexit has dealt a heavy blow on the whole world. It's such a sudden surprise. And the European Union is such an important cross-country governance structure, and I believe it is worthwhile discussing the impact, the implications of Brexit under this forum. And Minister Li, as a representative of China, is the most authoritative person to talk about the implications of Brexit and China's opinion on that subject.
I want to once again thank the moderator for giving me this opportunity. And I have heard the expectations and comments from the other speakers. I was very much inspired. And I believe it would help us further improve our preparation for the outcome documents and some action plans. I believe such dialogue is very meaningful. Just now, the moderator mentioned a very hot topic, that is Brexit, which has triggered some market volatilities. Then what kind of impact will this have on the world? First, I want to emphasize that China is very much committed to our sound cooperative relationship with the UK. We enjoy a very friendly relationship, and we and our cooperation cover a wide range of areas. We would love to see a stable and prosperous United Kingdom and a stable and prosperous Europe. But of course, we respect the choice made by the British people. It is their own decision. We also respect the development path chosen by Europe. Just like China, we want others to respect our development model and development path. We need such mutual respect. When does such mutual respect matter? It is at such crucial moments of challenges that mutual respect really makes a difference. And we hope to see stability at this particular point of time. We are actually confident about the fundamentals of the British economy and the European economy. A stable and prosperous UK and EU is in the interest of everyone and in the interest of the world economy. But now, the UK has already voted to leave the EU. It is a sudden challenge, but we can't be disrupted. We can't be at our wit's end. We can't just panic. And we hope and we believe that the UK and the EU will reach agreement through negotiations and realize a steady transition. We are confident about that. And China is ready to continue to help relevant parties to create relevant conditions for such a steady transition. We would love to see steady growth of the world economy. So that is our wish. The third G20 Sherpa meeting was concluded yesterday, and at that meeting, we saw Brexit. So sometimes accidents happen. Just now, the panelists and the speakers talked about what kind of role the G20 can play. I believe that since the global financial crisis in 2008, the G20 has played an important role in stabilizing the global market and promoting international economic governance. We have properly dealt with the impact of the global financial crisis. But of course, there have been some pains in the process. But we have found the way forward. On the whole, the world economy is in much a better shape than in 2008. And this is a reality we must recognize. Although the growth is still sluggish, but the world economy is much more solid than before. We must realize strong, sustainable, and balanced growth, and in particular, inclusive growth. This is quite different from people's expectations back in 2008. And this in itself shows that the world economy is moving forward and is moving forward steadily. But there are still some uncertainties in the process. Well, after years of development and improvement, the G20 can help us deal with and forecast these issues. Brexit has brought along some challenges, but as we have been dealing with previous challenges, we need to stay united in the face of such a challenge. We also mentioned Brexit at yesterday's Sherpa meeting. Like my counterpart from Turkey, we agree that we must stay calm and closely follow the developments of the situation calmly and stay united, jointly respond to the challenge, boost confidence, and stabilize the market. Any accidents could trigger some reactions. Some might be quite unexpected. Some people might panic. Some people simply react how other people react. Well, G20 is the most important platform for international economic governance. So the Sherpa meeting believed that we must stay calm and recognize that the economic fundamentals are sound. And we need to analyze whether this is an economic question or a political decision. It may seem to be more of a political system. It is not a problem with the economy. But maybe behind this political decision, we can see the impact of some economic problems. And this is something that our G20 members must reflect on.
Thank you very much, Minister Lee. Time is very limited.
I want to emphasize one point. We all believe for the Hangzhou Summit to be successful, this Sherpa meeting is highly crucial. The problems we now face has highlighted the importance that the G20 must transition from a crisis response mechanism towards a long-term mechanism, long-term governance mechanism. And it is highly imperative that we achieve this transition. We all have the same desire, that is, all the parties are supportive of China in making this summit a success. All the participants expressed such a desire at the meeting.
Asher, may I play a follow-up question? Because the George Soros, he just warned the whole world that maybe the worst scenario for the Brexit would be a collapse of the EU, actually. Would it be the worst scenario of the Brexit? What is your take on that? Very briefly, I'm sorry.
In fact, this will be a speculation because there are different, let's say, interpretations of the Brexit. For example, I listened today to Mr. Rubin's interpretation. Of course, I mean, it is having effect, but how long and how much we will see. Still, I mean, it's an evolving process. But I think that's why maybe the G20, only during the crisis times, in fact, people remember the importance of the G20. Because after the 2008 financial crisis, we have elevated, as it was been verbalized, to the leaders' summit level. And now, I mean, when we had 2008 financial crisis, this global crisis, none of us were immune, in fact, from the impact of the crisis. But we succeeded, in fact, to establish a more solid financial system. I think the G20 has played a very important role, and we can take credit a little bit from this success. And we will continue within the G20 to have macroeconomic coordination and effective communication, as Minister Lee pointed out. In fact, we discussed this issue also within the Sherpa. And of course, it will be on the agenda of our finance ministers, because every developing new risk or uncertainty are being discussed, in fact, within the G20. But I think in comparison with the 2008 financial crisis, I'm sure that we are very confident we will address this issue together.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Asha, for giving us this strong confidence. Of course, Brexit is not the collapse of Lehman Brothers.
Everything. 我想呢，我们 有时间问一个问题。
We have time for one question only. The gentleman over there.
这个一个问题。
Very quick question, and please identify to whom the question is directed.
Over the last 15 years, China invested approximately 1 billion euro every year in the UK, making the UK the largest destination for Chinese investment in Europe. So how do you think Chinese companies will react to this Brexit news? Will they, leave the UK to move their HQ outside of elsewhere in Europe and more globally, how do you think this will change the patterns of Chinese investment in the UK?
Yeah, thank you very much. Very good question, but I'm afraid that none of the four of the panelists are the B20 or the business people, but maybe Baodong Buzhang can share some view on it very briefly.
Yeah, thank you very much for your question. I think it's very, very important one, and also many people also they want to look at what reaction from China. And certainly, you know, I think that I cannot speak on behalf of the business people, but I think the general feeling is that we really attach great importance to our relations with UK, and also we want to see the prosperity and growth of the economy in UK, and also confident in the fundamentals economy, UK, and also in Europe. And I think, generally speaking, you know, we want to develop long-term relationship. So what does that mean? Means, you know, once you are in difficulties, your partners will help you. And I don't believe that Chinese philosophy, you know, just abandon our friends, abandon our partners, and leave, you know, our counterparts, you know, at the time of difficulties. I think what we need is a solidarity and helping each other. So I believe, so the Chinese businessmen, they will act in a very responsible way. And as I said, generally speaking, we do feel confident, you know, in the long run, that the good relationship between China and UK, and also the business opportunities for the Chinese economy, and also for Chinese businessmen. So this is a two-way traffic. In the meantime, we hope that our friends in UK can handle this also in a very professional way and calm down the situation a little bit. And so pretty confident that the solution can be found, and the G20 and other international organizations also, you know, will be helpful to relax the situation a little bit. As Ayse mentioned, they're going to have financial and also central bankers meeting very soon, and early next month we're going to have a commercial ministers meetings be held in Shanghai. So I think these meetings also will help and clarify the situation, and also to rebuild the confidence and help that build the market confidence. Thank you very much.
好，非常感谢 宝东部长。我想
Thank you, Vice Minister Li, and maybe Mr. Zhang and Professor Li, you can comment briefly about 30 seconds each. Oh, okay, 30 seconds. So briefly, you touched upon a very important point. So what does it depend on? It depends on the investor community's judgment of what's going to happen to the UK. I saw it as a shock, not so much a crisis. And we have already saw the fallout of the shock in the short term. But for the medium and long term, I don't think the shock will have a major impact, at least not as big as we expect. So there's over estimation and exaggeration of the impact, because we have to test your hypothesis next year, because in terms of GDP, it's only a 2% by BPP terms, but it has a huge financial clout. So there will be pains and impact, and it's for confidence blow, and it's also for market activities. About your question, whether Chinese investors will keep going there, whether Chinese investors will move their money elsewhere to other European countries. So as I said, it depends on our medium-term outlook. If the consensus view is that the UK is not going to be promising, then I think it's probably wise to move the money. When it comes to investment in the UK, in the EU, there's a number of investment classes, asset classes, property and also acquisition of high-tech firms. I don't see these two types of investment activities to be affected by Brexit, because the proposition here is the economic dividends of the UK. There's another type that is greenfield investment, building factories in the UK and using the UK's access to the EU as a member. So getting zero tariff treatment for this type of investment, it might get some, it may suffer. But I see such investments mostly concentrating Romania and Central and Eastern Europe. So I don't see China's investment in the UK being affected to a large extent, even with Brexit. We have very limited time, so we have to wrap up. I would like to ask the four speakers to conclude and summarize a little bit, and I want them to move back to the G20 agenda. So the question to all of you is
of this year's G20 under the presidency of China. 就是我们怎么样了，我们就算成功了，我觉得这个是一个非常。
So how do we determine success? What are your metrics? What is your biggest expectation in this regard? So Professor Zhang, you first, and Mr. Li, and Ayse and Mr. Li. So in one word to summarize, I think that is a very difficult question because it's a very big question to answer using just one sentence or two. I have a high target and a low target. So the high ambitious target is the heads of state of G20 states come to China and discuss issues of the world seriously, and then exchange views and present viable solutions. That's my expectation for what is happening, and I see that as success. I would like to liken it to organizing a banquet, because the Chinese are very hospitable. So it has to be delicious and also useful. So the G20 in China will have to set the agenda for the next meeting in Germany, and also we have to stabilize. We have to act as a ballast.
I'm already confident that the Hangzhou meeting will be a big success, because the Chinese presidency has made very concrete, let's say, successful, reached very successful conclusions. There are lots of action plans, because for the G20, the most important things is turn our words into action, and China is doing that. In fact, in all across all working groups, our working groups are working to produce action plans, which will provide a good basis for our leaders to discuss. And the teams are very important. As I said, that these are the teams for the future of our economies. And we will continue, in fact, after China, of course, to reflect upon all these important issues.
Thank you, Baodong 部长.
就是在, 推动
As we work to promote strong, sustainable, and balanced economic growth of the world, we need to have greater consensus and find a new way forward, that is innovation-driven development. Through structural reform, through development, through greater trade and investment, I believe these three areas is where we can achieve success.
I would like to thank the four panelists, and also thank you to all of you for coming. So we expect the Hangzhou meeting in September to be a complete success.
Thank you so much.